Now that we've looked a little bit at what a normal distribution is and what it looks like, and very briefly we looked at a uniform distribution, let's look at how to generate random numbers in MATLAB. So I'm going to discuss three types of random numbers that we can generate, although there are more within MATLAB. I'll start with the most basic, which is going to be just RAND, and for right now I'll use it without any of the arguments. So we see if I just run this, what is it doing? If I keep rerunning over and over again, rand makes a random number uniformly distributed between 0 and 1, meaning that it's going to pick a digit between 0 or a number between 0 and 1 inclusive, but it can be any number between 0 and 1, any decimal between there, and there's an equal probability that any number is chosen. So again, every time I run it, it's making a different random number between 0 and 1. And we can also use rand, and we can use the other versions of random also to make not only a single number a scalar, but we can make vectors and we can make matrices. So the other arguments that rand takes are the dimensions of the vector or the matrix, really the matrix that we want to make. Because let's see what happens if I just put a 2 there, it assumes I want to make a 2x2 matrix. Again, all of random numbers. So I do, if I want a vector, have to explicitly put a 1 there. So in this case, it's 1 row, 2 columns, or I can have 2 rows and 1 column. Or if I want a big vector, I can have 1,000 completely random numbers between 0 and 1, and I'm going to make 1,000 of them by doing this. Now let me make a big vector of these random numbers. I'm going to save that to x, and let me suppress this. So I have 1,000 values here. So let's see what happens if I generate all 1,000 of these values. Let's look at what we learned before of how the histogram works, and now we can put them into bins. So I'm going to just use the default 10 for right now when I make my histogram. And we see here that it's not exactly uniform between 0 and 1. If it was exactly uniform, what's going to happen? We should have the same number in every bin that we have. So we should have the same number between 0 and 0.1, 0.1 and 0.2, 0.2 and 0.3. But because these are randomly generated, there's a chance that it makes more in some bin, some one bin, than in another. So we see that it made kind of more than we expected. We would expect if it was completely uniform throughout, it should make 100 in each bin, since right now there's 10 bins and 1,000 values. But yeah, it's selecting them randomly, so there's a chance that, let's just reduce it down to kind of the most basics here. If I just choose 2, so in this case it chose 2 that were near each other, here randomly it's 0.2 and 0.4, and if I go with 10, it's not necessarily going to have 1 in each bin since it's doing it randomly. So let's go back to 1,000 and replot the histogram here of all the numbers that it did choose to use. So yeah, it's not exactly uniform, but it's relatively flat and across. But we're going to see that the more points I use, it starts to flatten out more and more. And what we get as I use, let's go all the way up to 1,000,000 randomly selected points. Here, it's pretty much uniform. So it has the same number of points in every bin. So between 0 and 0.1, etc., I have the same number of randomly generated data points. And we'll see the utility of this in a little bit, of making a lot of random numbers, because we're going to use that when we do simulations. So in the most basic way, I'm just using rand. Again, all rand ever does is make a number between 0 and 1 with equal probability that it's any number between 0 and 1. But what if I want to make a set of numbers that are not just between 0 and 1, but on a specific interval? So let's say we want it to be between, on the interval A to B, inclusive. So let's just say in this case that I want to generate random numbers that are between 10 and 20. And I still want to use rand here. So what I can do here, since rand is making numbers between 0 and 1, I'm going to add A, and then I can multiply by what I'm going to call the range here, so B minus A, and multiply that by rand. So let's just study quickly what's going on here. B minus A in this case is 10. So I'm multiplying 10 by a number between 0 and 1, meaning that the smallest this product is going to be is 0, the biggest is going to be is 10. So this part of it is going to randomly select a number between 0 and 10. And over here, when I'm adding A to it, that's always 10. So it's going to be 10 plus a number that ranges between 0 and 10, which means that in the end, x is going to be between 10 and 20. And let's make sure that this works the way we think it does. So let me rerun this. And now we see, running our histogram, that we only have data between 10 and 20. And if we look at x, our min is 10, and our max goes up to 20. And again, looking at this basically uniform probability of numbers between 10 and 20. Now let's just say I wanted between 10 and 30. Rerun this, and again, we get the same basic results here. We have an equal probability of choosing a number, any number, between 10 and 30. All right, so let's move on to using randn, which works in a similar method here. So go back to the basics of what we're doing. Get rid of the histogram for right now, and just run the basic randn. So again, by rerunning this, it's making these random numbers, but now because it's randn, it's making a random number, but it's selected from a normal distribution with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. So in this case, we can get numbers that are going to be not have an equal probability of being chosen, but we're more likely to select numbers near 0 and less likely to select numbers to the right of 0 or to the left of 0, but still with some probability. And we can use arguments the same way that we used it before. So I'm going to make a vector of 1 million random numbers from a normal distribution. So again, if I print this all out, it's a million numbers. I don't want to look at their actual values. So let me stop this. And I just want to do that, and I'll save this in X again. So we see in our workspace, X is a million random numbers, but now from a normal distribution, not a uniform distribution. Now let's see if we do our histogram here, what that looks like. So we have a million data points here, so ten bins is not going to be a good way to look at this data. If remember, we can use the Sturges' rule here for the number of bins. So remember that we use the ceiling of the 2 log of the length of x plus 1. And this is the recommendation according to Sturges' rule of how many bins to use. So they say for a million data points, we should be using 20 bins to really see how the data looks. All right, so rerunning this, this looks now like we have a normal distribution. It's that bell-shaped curve, similar to the examples that we looked at before. So it's not a uniform distribution. Let me show the difference again. If I go back to just rand, and rerun this. Now it's choosing numbers with equal probability between 0 and 1, but when I pull from a normal distribution, now I'm more likely to select values near the mean of 0, and then the further and further out I get from 0, the less frequently I'll be selecting numbers out from there. I'm going to look at if I use 10 times more, so 10 million points. Again, it looks more and more and more like that normal distribution. And if we do our normality test on this, of x, and we save our h and our p. All right, we have a lot of data points, so it takes a little bit for it to run. But we see here that it does pass the Lilliefors normality test. The h is 0, indicating it is probably from a random a normal distribution, which we know it is because we generated the data, and the p-value is above 0.05. In contrast, if I change this once again back to rand, so uniform distribution, and I rerun this, and I put now this uniform distribution through the Lilliefors test, we should expect with this many data points, we see that it fails the normality test. And again, visually, it does not look normal like the last example did. All right, so let's step this back down to a million and get rid of our Lilliefors test for the moment. Just like with the uniform distribution, I don't necessarily only ever want numbers that have a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. However, that's what rand always creates. So let's say, for instance, that I was looking at the stature from before. I knew from the previous example that the mean value, I'll use just approximations for right now, was about 1700 millimeters. Now let's just say that for our population, the standard deviation was 50 millimeters. So again, this is my mean is 1700, the standard deviation of 50. And if I run this, it has to be randn for the normal distribution, we see what the data looks like here. So again, our mean is at 1700, and we see most of our data points are close to 1700, and then the further out we go, the less likely we are to be drawing from those data points. But let's see how the standard deviation affects the shape of our histogram. So let me rerun this again so it's all kind of the same size here. I'll keep this up so we can keep looking out. Keeps closing it. Let me do a CLF instead. As we rerun this, it basically looks the same. Again, these are randomly generated. But let's say we increase our standard deviation to 100. We see that because of the scaling, it's a little bit deceptive, but we see that these tails go out now to 1400 and to 2000. Let's do that in contrast to where we had a smaller standard deviation. We saw the tails only went to 1550, and this tail went to about 1850. So what's happening here is that the standard deviation is showing the spread of the data. So let me actually make two different sets of data so that we can compare what happens when we change that standard deviation, and I can plot them at the same time. Okay, so looking here, blue is with 50, the yellow is with a standard deviation of 100, and if I keep increasing the value of the yellow here, we see that the yellow gets more and more spread out the more our standard deviation increases. Now, the scaling to this isn't great, so the comparison starts to kind of lose value as I keep going spread further and further. But again, to reiterate, the standard deviation is a description of how spread out the data is from the mean. So if they start closer together, we can see a much better comparison here. The yellow has a higher standard deviation. It's a little bit more spread out than the blue is. And the last type of random number we can generate is a contrast to the first two, rand and randn, which is what are called continuous distributions. It can pick any decimal number between two bounds, rand being uniform and randn being a normal distribution. We also have randi, which is going to pick only integer values. So the most basic way to use randi, we can use it with one argument. So here I put in 10. That means it's going to generate, every time I run this, an integer between 1 and 10 inclusive. So it only picks those integer values, and it's going to pick them uniformly. And then the other arguments I can give it, similar to the previous two, I can make a vector of, in this case, 1,000 values between 1 and 10 inclusive. And then if I look at a histogram, histograms don't work too well for integer values. They work better for discrete data. But we see that, again, it's pretty uniform. But here, if I look at the actual values in X, they're only integer values. Now, integer values, or randi, is great for the types of things in probability that are discrete types of choices. So, for example, if we're flipping a coin, it can only be heads or tails. If we're picking a card from a standard deck, it can only be one of 52 choices. If we roll a die, it can only be one of 6 choices. So one way that we can use this, let's say we are flipping a coin here, we can have one represent heads and two represent tails, for example. And now what this simulates is 1,000 coin flips. So again, it's every time we run it, it's going to be different values here. And this simulates, we flip, for example, here, starting at 931, a head, then a tail, then a tail, then a tail, then a head. And this is good because all of those events have equal probability, just like rolling a die, just like picking a random card from a deck. So in that case, if we were picking a card from a deck, we could have 52 things happen. And then it's going to represent here, this would be if we pick a card and then put it back into the deck. So if each number represented a specific card in the deck, this would be a simulation of picking a card, putting it back, randomly selecting a card, putting it back, and recording it. So again, to reiterate, the random integer is good for these discrete type of events, whereas rand and randn are good for events that come over a continuous distribution that we'll look at in some examples in a little bit here. One more way to use randi. So remember here that randi will go and pick starting at 1 and go up to that first argument. So if we don't want to be starting at 1, say we want to, I'll use this a and b from before, I want to pick integers between 10 and 30 inclusive. So I don't want it to ever pick 1 through 9, just 10, 11, 12, etc. up to 30. So what I can do to adjust this is I can have my lowest point, in this case it's a little bit different than the other ones, I'm going to add a minus 1 to rand I of b minus a plus 1. And then generate that. Right, so I'm actually, just so we can see these discrete data points here, I'm just going to plot the values of x. So we can see, it doesn't give us a great idea, but we can see that it takes a value of 10, some of them are 11, 12, etc., all the way up to 30. So this is a good way at least to check the bounds that you have from the random integer. So we start at 10 is the lowest number ever chosen, 30 is the highest, and we see integer values all between there. And just for one more example, let me just do a smaller matrix. We can make not only the vector, but the matrix. Here, if I print I here, I made a 10 by 10 matrix of numbers between 10 and 30 inclusive. I'd say for many of the things we do, a vector is going to be a good enough for what we're going to be using. Now, the last thing I want to talk about here is, how is the computer actually computing these numbers? How is it choosing every time I run rand one more time? How is it making it a different number each time and it's not repeating? And there doesn't seem to be, if we checked into it, a discernible pattern for how it's choosing these numbers. Well, it's not actually thinking of numbers randomly. This is actually what's called a pseudo-random pick, that there is an underlying formula that the computer is using to generate these numbers. So these are not truly random numbers, but they are random enough for most things that we want to use random numbers for, and we'll see that in the coming examples.